Greetings from Tokyo. This is Daisuke, and I am very, very happy today because we are joined by a very special guest. This is John, and I think many of you might be already familiar with John because he has a very great love of cinema, and that love of cinema is shown in a lot of avenues and respects online, including his great YouTube channel. And so I look forward to talking with John about that and other aspects of cinema. But before I get into those details, let me just welcome John. Welcome. Welcome. It's a real pleasure. Thank you very much for your time today.
No, thank you for inviting me, Daisuke. I've been looking forward to this. When I received your message, I've been eagerly awaiting talking to you.
Oh, you're too kind. Thank you so much. I think we know each other, but I think this is our first time to just have a nice sit down, casual chat about all things cinema. So I thought, with many things going on, many new releases and the like, I thought it would be just a fun time. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. I'm looking forward to it immensely.
Well, my pleasure. Thanks, Pierre.
And so I guess before we get started, John, if you don't mind, maybe for the benefit in particular of those who might be watching this and might be meeting you for the first time, could you let us know a little bit about yourself and also maybe start with your wonderful YouTube channel?
Well, the name's John, and I started the thoughts of a YouTube channel a long time before I actually did the YouTube channel. I think there's a lot of people who do that. To think about it, and then they kind of put it off, and you put them with barriers to think, I can't do it, but you do it, and then you don't look back after you do it. It's initial setting it up that's the hard part, I feel. When I talk to people about it, they think that it's going to be, it's the initial starting it up. So when I started it up, I've never looked back, really. But I think when I was initially starting it up, I think about it, it was the likes of yourself, Daisuke, when I was watching your videos and I was watching the way you presented them, which made me think about it's more than, there's more to this than just showing off videos, there's talking about it, that there's getting involved with people with a similar interest. And I think that's been the best thing about YouTube, is finding out people who share that same love for certain types of cinema, which you don't really get in real life. You can talk to people at work and talk to people in your life and they don't really share that. But online, you can seek these people out who share your love and you can just talk forever, which is a bit of a dream for somebody who's a fan of movies, to talk to somebody forever about movies. Whereas in your real life, if you try and do that, people kind of zone out quite quickly. So that was initial sort of feeling behind doing the channel.
And before we move forward with some other discussion, what is the wonderful name of your channel?
Well, the name of the channel is Mondo Chellovec Movies. Now, a little bit of story behind that is the fact is that way back when I was playing music with my friends, we had bands and stuff like that. We all did stuff and I got a recording studio in my garage. So I thought I'm going to have to get a name for this solo project. Now, when I was looking through movies, especially, I thought, what are some good names that couple together? And Mondo, to me, talks about the sort of extreme horror that you can get. And that sort of gives you the horror, you know, Mondo cinema, exploitation cinema. So that gets that. And Chellovec is from A Clockwork Orange, my favorite book. And it's means a young man, so it's just I put those two together because I thought it kind of played out quite well. And then when I made the channel, I thought, what can I call it? John's Movies or John's Thoughts? And I thought, well, it's quite generic, so I thought I'll just take Mondo Chellovec and just put movies on the end. And then that's how that became. And I hope that it stood out from the crowd, you see, rather than just being a generic name, if you know what I mean.
I think it's very cool. I think it's really, really cool. I like it. How should I follow up with that? How should I explain? So you were trying to make up your razoo docs what to call your channel, and you ended up with Mondo Chellovec Movies. I love it. That's wonderful. And so,
yes,
thank you very much. Thank you for yes. So you mentioned then Mondo, which of course, as you just I think described, carries with it a certain significance regarding a genre or subgenre of cinema. So maybe is this an indication of the type of, again, for the benefit of people who might be meeting you for the first time, is this an indication of some of the types of films or genres that you are into?
Well, actually, to be honest, in 2004, when I came up with the name, I was kind of more into sort of Mondo cinema at that time. I think I've branched away from that, but it does sort of give somebody a sort of inkling that they're going to get some kind of extreme cinema here, whether it be video nasties or it be sort of extreme sort of like foreign movies that are just a little bit too aggressive for the normal palate. So for me, I think that it doesn't mean that you're going to get movies like Faces of Death all the time. I might mention Faces of Death, but it's a kind of it kind of points in the direction that you will see or hear me talking about my love for extreme horror, maybe more than extreme cinema.
What are some examples of the types of films that you love to talk about on your channel?
Well, at the moment, I'm doing a live stream every so often about video nasties, and we're going through, me and a co-host called Nige, we'll go through the video nasties, went through the whole section one. We're going to start section two next month, and we'll pick 10 titles, and we'll talk about those. We'll talk about stuff behind them, like thoughts behind them. Is the movie good or not? Is the movie justified to be really low on internet movie database? And also, how much we enjoyed it, and whether or not you can get a hold of it. Is it going to be uncut if you get a hold of it? Is it impossible to get a hold of? Have we seen it? Is it one of the ones that we actually own, or has it got a 4K even? Which would have never dreamed about talking about 4K with, you know, video nasties, but it's happening at the moment. So it's quite an exciting time in that respect. So I think that the movies that we're talking about are, that you can say it's like banned horror movies. That can be the sort of extreme part of it. But also you get movies like Martyrs and things that come across that you think, wow, that's extreme. You know, and Tetsuo, that you can say that's got this extreme element to it, which is fascinating, but it's not for everybody. And I think that's why we like talking about it, because we know that there's a niche market for these things, but I don't hear that many people talking about this niche side of cinema widely.
Very interesting. And I suppose a follow-up would be, what were some of those examples of films maybe that you discovered that led you into this cinema interest?
Well, we grew up, me and Nige grew up in the video nasties explosion. It was happening to us in real life, in real time. So we were quite familiar with the fact of one day walking past the video library shop with the Driller Killer in the window, the picture, thinking, I have got to go and see that movie. And then when you actually get a little bit older and you actually go in and buy these things or rent them, they're not there. And it's become apparent that they've been banned. Now, as soon as you hear the word banned, you think, I have got to see this movie. It is top of my list.
Yeah.
And so we spent from about 1984 to literally the early 90s trying to source out these movies. And you had to get them by nefarious acts. You had to know somebody who knew somebody who could get these movies from you. And it was quite... It was quite a weird time, because at times you could be prosecuted. People could be prosecuted for supplying these, but you would get them off friends and stuff that get passed around. So it was a bit of a really strange time to get these movies. Now, fast forward, that was a time which made me interested in extreme movies like, you know, Lucio Fulci, Dario Argento. It brought them to my attention. And then when Arrow came out and then they started to release these movies properly, that's when the bug really hit, because you were seeing these movies probably for the first time. Your favorite movie of that is Zombie Flesh Eaters or Zombie. And to see that coming out now in glorious 4K is like a dream come true, actually.
So this is very interesting, of course. So so that means you were speaking, of course, of the time in the you mentioned the 80s in the UK, and this idea of sort of the video nasties and films that were either unavailable, or maybe they might have been made available under heavily edited circumstances or the like. So I have a connection, in the sense that I was a kid growing up for a little bit in Surrey, England, maybe in the late 80s, early 90s or so. So just for a span of a few years, but I was around. And so I knew a little bit about going to the video store and not necessarily getting the videos or the titles that you might have heard about from reading, I don't know, Fangoria magazine or something like that, or hearing about, I know there's a lot of overlap, and it's kind of a broad and amorphous subject in terms of what is a video nasty specifically, or what might have been considered a part of that group in a broad way. But you mentioned names like Argento and Lucio Fulci, and also there are also films that were unavailable too. Like, for instance, I was around at the time when a film like, say, The Exorcist wouldn't be right. You wouldn't be able to see it, right? And it would be like. And I was there when I first began to become aware of this legendary film in my eyes, but I couldn't watch it. The best thing that I could do when I was living in England at the time to get a sense of what The Exorcist was to watch the beginning of Exorcist II, The Heretic, because it had a little bit of, in the international version on the VHS, it had a little bit of a flashback with still pictures of what happened in the previous film. Yeah. So, but you're right when you say too, and I totally understand, is that when you get this lack of availability, that makes it even more appealing, and you want to see it, whatever it is, and then you end up being able to see it, making reference to what could be said to be like a glory age right now in terms of Arrow and other labels that are able to release these releases in these glorious and sometimes definitive versions, as you rightly point out. Yes, I totally agree. Yeah.
Well, it's interesting because I think a lot of people think the video nasties happened for a certain short period of time around about 83, 84. But I think it continued on long after that. And at that time, The Exorcist in the late 90s, and also Clockwork Orange, couldn't get a hold of that. There was things like Man Bites Dog, which was hard to get in the UK. And there was Necromantic came out, and they were in Germany, and they were thinking, you can't get that. There was a lot of cons. And these days, you can count on like one finger how many movies don't get released in the UK or get like fall foul or something. But back in the day, it was really hard. And it became a bit of a quest. And maybe if that didn't happen, but the best thing about it, if that didn't happen, I probably wouldn't know half the stuff I know today because of that incident. And it helped me, actually, when I look at it, when I was in the middle of it, I was cursing the fact that I couldn't see these movies, and I was like denied it. But looking back on it, it was probably a help, because it set me to get some of my most favorite movies. The names were popping up, The Beyond, all these type of stuff, The Burning. And you just thought, I've got to see these movies. And sometimes they weren't that great, and sometimes they really lived up and your expectations were like met. So it was a fun time looking back on it.
What are some examples of those titles that really met your expectations, or then some, when you finally were able to find them and watch them?
Well, funny enough, Zombie, when I, the first time I watched these, were usually on fifth generation bootleg copies, and they were very hard to see. One that didn't meet my expectations was Driller Killer. I thought Driller Killer was going to be exceptional, and it's not. Well, I didn't think it was, because the copy was that bad. So fast forward to now, I really love the Driller Killer, because I can see it in a good presentation from Arrow, and I can get what the movie's about. Zombie, weirdly enough, even though I couldn't really make out what was going on, I did know I was watching something special. And because I've always been a huge fan of Dawn of the Dead, and that was another one that was a bit hard, a bit tricky to get a hold of, and especially the uncut one. And we were searching for the uncut one, the director's cut. Now, Dawn of the Dead was always more available than I'd saw at the cinema, actually, on re-release, which was spectacular. And so I could kind of relate to Dawn of the Dead more, and Zombie was kind of in the background, but with Zombie becoming available on DVD, then Blu-ray, then 4K, it's become a movie that I've respected enormously, because I can see what Fulci was doing behind the scenes. It wasn't just a splatterfest. There was something else about it, which I couldn't see when I was looking at these bootleg copies. So Zombie was one of the main ones that's come from zero to hero in the space of time. The Burning as well. The Burning is absolutely brilliant. It's one of those ones that you forget how good it is. You go back to it afterwards and you say, I've just watched it recently and I couldn't believe how much I enjoyed it. Other movies like the Beyond, the Fulci movies, the funny thing about them is I didn't understand how they never used to make sense at the end. And I used to be scratching my head for most of the time thinking, what did I just watch there? But now I've come to know that I can live with that. I think with maturity as well, because a lot of these films you watch when you were a kid and you just wanted to see the worst thing you could ever see. But looking back on it, you can understand that maybe they weren't the worst things you could ever see, but they've got this different feeling, this different flavor. Plus as well, it opened up the doors for Italian cinema to me. If I watched these movies and I would think, hang on, if these movies are that good from Argento and Fulci, I would have to go and check other people out. And I've went on a bit of a search for Giallo. Giallo came up and I didn't even know what Giallo was. Then getting into that and knowing there was like loads of Giallo was another one that really excited us, because I knew there was a wealth of movies out there that I would like, but I haven't seen yet. Yeah. So it kind of opened the doors for me in a way that I don't really know until later, until after the fact, if you know what I mean.
No, I can relate to that. Yes. I mean, I remember, for instance, when I was in the UK at the time, that was when Dawn of the Dead was kind of officially released on VHS. And I remember Evil Dead also was made available on VA. That was around that time. So these were big deals at that. I didn't quite understand and appreciate just how big a deal that was. Even when watching that version of Dawn of the Dead, it was not just the theatrical cut on VHS, but it was edited down so as to remove the maybe some of the more gruesome bits that you would otherwise be able to see in the so-called regular theatrical cut now with all the great releases now. But back in the day, you couldn't you would watch it and I would be expecting, oh, I can't wait to see all these Tom Savini special effects, and you'd watch it and be, hey, that wasn't so bad. Where are all the carnage and where are all the scenes? And I didn't realize until later that those had been further edited out for purposes of those releases. So you had that extra level of inaccessibility. But sometimes you'd be able to get, at least based on my experience, I don't know about you, but sometimes you'd get these films that would be edited or made not available. But then you'd have these other examples of films that would be made available and you could see. Yeah. Go to the rental store and see, like, for instance, this was late 80s. You probably know this too. This was around the time of Hellraiser and Hellbound Hellraiser 2. And those were quite intense films, but those I think were made generally available and the like, as well as other titles of a similar vein. So it was an interesting time, kind of almost confusing in a way, what was considered inappropriate, what wasn't, you know, for purposes of mass market consumption.
Yeah, I agree. It's really funny looking back on it. I think when one of the funny things when you're on YouTube and you're talking about people from a different generation, and you're saying about this is what happened. And if they are used to, as I would imagine most young people, I'm talking maybe 20 to 30 year olds, can go in and just help themselves to anything they want in HMV to a certain extent. And if they wanted to go and see Dawn of the Dead, they can see the fullest cut. They can have the choice and that amazing box set that you've got of all the cuts if they wanted to. And it was so impossible to see the longest cut or the Argento cut. Back in the day, it was really hard to source them. And if you did, the quality was awful. So when you start talking about the fact of saying that I really wanted to see A Clockwork Orange, then there was no way in the world I could get my hands on it, because And they were saying, is it banned? I said, well, it wasn't really banned. It was kind of the director didn't want it released in the UK because he thought we couldn't handle it. Subject matter, because there was a lot of copycat stuff happening in the early 70s.
Yeah.
But it's weird. I think it's weird to find out that it's good to have their input to think of how they see that from people who don't have that thing happening at all. And I think they sometimes like the fact of hearing this thing, because it's like a bit of a bygone age. It's a fact of English heritage that happened in cinema, that if you weren't there, you don't really understand the kind of workings on it. And I think when me and Nige talk about it, people get a flavour of what we came up against. And it's usually everyone who was in the middle of this video nasties like problem will have the same story. We'll have the same thing where you say you went out to somebody's house and then the dad would have a copy of The Burning and would say, put it on. And would be loads of people around the VHS or Betamax watching The Burning and going back to school and telling everyone we saw The Burning. So it was a great strange time, but it's good that you can talk about it now and sort of pass that on to other people, and it's a good talking point, actually.
No, fully agreed. Yeah, well said, well said. And I'll, before I forget, I want to ask you, so you also mentioned, Fulci also mentioned Argento, so I'm a big fan of both. So what are some examples of Argento films that you particularly like?
Well, it was funny. I've got a friend called John Hall, and he was the one who we sort of shared this love for the band horror stuff together. And he sussed out more movies than me at a quicker rate. And he was watching like different movies. He's got a huge knowledge of Italian cinema and about cinema in general. So he was telling me about he told me about Dario Argento, and he told me about the movies that I would be seen by Dario Argento. And I was a big Fulci fan, and I said, well, is it zombies? They said, no, not really. You're going to see other things. It's Suspiria. He's going to say, you're going to... And he sold me by saying, you've never seen a movie that looked so spectacular as a horror film. And I didn't really get the fact that horror films could look sensational in that fashion, you know, like artistic. So when I first saw Suspiria for the first time, couldn't believe what I was watching, but it was off the whole, the colors, the way it was put together. It's like a sort of, it's like a fairy tale, like an adult fairy tale of this strange witch's coven. And it's not the usual splatterfest. And that led me into watching. So also as well, and he talked about giallo. So he said, I'm going to give you the best example of a giallo, he thought, which was Deep Red. So I said, right, okay, I'll watch Deep Red. And he said, I watched it with him. And he said, he brought it over because he had the disc, he had the tape. So he brought it over the mine. And it was a shorter cut. It wasn't the longer cut at the time. And he said that in this movie, without any spoilers, he said, something happens in the movie, and if you see it, you will understand the movie in a different way than if you don't see it. And I watched it, and I did see the part. But I had such a great time with it, and I love that movie. And the music in it is astounding. I wasn't used to hearing. I was used to the Goblin soundtrack from Dawn of the Dead, but to hear other Goblin stuff, I went, "This is good." So I watched it with my wife and my son, and my wife didn't see the part. My son did see the part. And it's great to watch people's thing, but to have a movie like that, a clever horror movie, I didn't really know that horror movies could be clever and stylish. So that's what made me gravitate to Argento with his giallo, love of giallo, and then also his love for stylish movies. And then you've got just basically all of his, I'm going to say his earlier work up until around about like an opera. I just have such a good time with him. I can just sit back and just think I'm watching something that's made by an amazing filmmaker.
I remember, yes, watching Deep Red for the first time as well. It was, what was it? It was the shorter cut, right? Because the longer Italian version wasn't available. So you could get the English, I guess, English language version that was shorter. Yeah. And Hatchet Murders was also the name sometimes applied to it. Mm-hmm. But yes, that was a phenomenal experience watching it for the first time. And then even more phenomenal when later with whatever DVD release that came out, you could then watch the, you had your choice of watching either that, that shorter version or the longer version, which had up to then I wasn't able to see. So I'm sure you had a similar experience with that as well.
Yes, I got both cuts on the DVD. Yeah. And I was so excited to see the extra footage. But funny enough, I don't know if you feel the same way, that the extra footage, it's good to know it's there. But I find the pacing of the shorter cut to be the definitive version for me. And sometimes I always go to the longer cut, like the Dawn of the Dead. Had to see the bits with the other bits in it because I was that familiar with the shorter cut. I wanted to know what else was in there, and I love the longer cut. And I love the Argento cut as well, which I never really got until I watched it on 4K. I didn't really realize that the Argento cut was just like a solid action movie, and the sort of pathos was gone. And it works a treat. So you've got, it's amazing how they did that. But I think that the longer cut for Deep Red does detract from the pacing of it slightly, I find. Do you find that, Daisuke?
Oh, I think it has a certain different flavor, that's for sure. Yeah. I mean, again, I don't want to go into too much detail, but there are certain, say, how should I put it, scenes involving the relationship dynamic between the main characters, let's put it that way. Yeah. So, and it might not necessarily mean you're getting more quote-unquote horror or special effects scenes per se, but you're getting more of the a character drama, or a lot of comedy as well. A lot of comedy scenes are there as well. So sometimes it works, sometimes it might take a little bit of getting used to. But I think overall, I think my go-to version more often than not is that longer version. But I know exactly what you're talking about in terms of the pacing of the shorter version. It does work very, very well as a tight, tight thriller.
Yes, it does. I think if I watch it with somebody, I will take the shorter cut. But what I do with myself is when I watch it by myself, I watch the shorter cut, then the longer cut will be the next time I watched it. Then I just alternate between the two of them when I watch that movie. But I find usually that the longer cuts of movies are, for me, the more enjoyable. And I like the fact that some of these movies, like I say, you couldn't have seen the full version at all. And then when it's available, you're so hungry for that longer cut that it becomes the definitive cut for you.
Well said. Well said. And now with these releases, you can get your choice of cuts and versions. You mentioned the Dawn of the Dead set, of course, which is and all the sets that you can get multiple versions now. You started to get that with the advent of DVD, of course, but now there's a full on, almost it's almost a baked in expectation now. You know that these releases will have multiple versions. If not, it's kind of a disappointment. You know, so
yeah. You
so, mean. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Go ahead, please. Yeah.
I'm just saying that you're spoiled for choice now, which is great.
It is.
I think we were denied for I would say about 10 years in the UK for the things. And now it's to have these movies at hand in this full. You see, if I say to somebody, I'll get a buzz out of owning the full version of a movie, which comes from the fact of not being able to see that movie at all, probably, and to have it in a glorious version of it is part of the charm and the feeling of that you've succeeded in getting the ultimate version of this movie. Because you're still on that quest. Though it's not really, you don't really have to have that quest anymore because the stuff's available. You can just walk the shop and pick it up in 2 seconds flat. But you've still got that thing to say, I'm holding in my hands something here that's special. And I think that makes me appreciate the stuff I've got a little bit more to the fact that I'm now got maybe on 4K that all the definitive versions of Argento movies, and I'm slowly getting the Lucio Fulci ones as well. And they're the two big ones from the past that I always wanted to have and never could get my hands on them. And so to have that little library of those stuff on the shelves is something that really brings home to you how lucky we are at this point to be able to have that in the UK, I find.
Yeah, well said. And I think too, was there something about the search or the unavailability of these things that maybe made you love the films even more? Is there something to that for you?
It is because there's movies that you just knew you could not get a hold of and at all, and to have the chance to actually physically get them. I think the initial search for it and the initial getting of the Clockwork Orange to get it for the I've got a Dutch one. No, it was from Finland, and it was I got it. I paid £30 for it, the VHS, and I've still got it. And to have actually an official, that's the thing. An official release of A Clockwork Orange in me hand, not a copy, not something that you couldn't see or hear, and it was garbage quality. That was something special about that. And then that actually it went on for quite a while because it took a long time to come out in the UK as well on DVD when it came out. So it's been some of these quests go on for a long time. It's not as if it's just one that lasts for a week or two. Sometimes these are like 10 years that you're searching for a movie that you literally kind of get a hold of. So it's good to I think it's just your appreciation factor goes through the roof when you pick up that version of that movie, and you finally it's as if you can move on then from that movie. You can move on from A Clockwork Orange. It doesn't haunt you. It becomes one that you can watch any time of day in the best quality available, and you can but your search is never going to be over. There's always one around the corner that is evading your capture.
And I think maybe in today's parlance, that might translate into titles that fall out of print, OOP and the like,
Oh,
trying to find those titles. It's a similar type of journey, I think,
yeah, it
from
is.
what you're speaking about. I understand.
Yeah, I'll often hear people talking about the fact that when they're talking about these movies that they. Any movie that we made, there might be a really strange comedy film that's out of print and they can't get a hold of it. And then it becomes that thing where and then somebody will say, well, I've got that. And they're like, wow, you've got that movie. And it could be something really strange or like you would think it was just, you could see it on the TV and stuff like that. But that's the modern day equivalent of that fear of missing out.
I totally
Right.
understand. So now I have to ask you, John. So you obviously have the love of cinema that has lasted for most, if not all, of your life. And so I can imagine that you grew up watching a lot of films in you mentioned the journey with video nasties and VHS. I can also imagine going to the movie theater and the like, and those sorts of experiences. So could you tell us a little bit about this background? What were some of those important movies that you saw, say, growing up during your cinema loving life that you could say really helped you and really convinced you that cinema was the way to go? So what were some of those important films for you in your life?
Well, I think that and a lot of people in the sort of in the UK felt the same way when we're talking about these movies online, is that on a Friday night, and don't forget we only had three channels in the UK, BBC One, BBC Two, and ITV. That was it. You had no choice apart from that, which is not bad in a way sometimes because sometimes we get too much choice these days and you don't know what to watch. But there was always a Friday night double bill of horror movies on. And the first ones I remember seeing was the Universal Monsters, Frankenstein, Dracula, Wolfman. And those really sort of stood out to me. And there was figures come out at the same time and you were playing these action figures. This is when I was about six. And I was quite petrified of them, but not too horrified by it. And then after that, I became aware of Hammer movies. There was a Hammer double bill. So you had the Hammer horror double bills. And they were equally as exciting, but more visceral. You can tell there was the color, there was blood everywhere. There was a lot more going on to a Hammer movie, and you knew this was like the next step for it. So when you leave that behind, then you go into the cinema. When you become of a certain age, where you can, you used to go to the cinema with your parents, would put you into the cinema for an afternoon matinee, and you go in the morning for two movies. You know, some kind of Journey to the Center of the Earth and a lot of Ray Harryhausen stuff. There was, you know, Sinbad. there was all of them movies, and you would get like a B movie on with it, and then you would be there for the full day. It was probably good for your parents just to get rid of you for the Saturday, and they can do what they wanted to do. So you put into them, then you kind of moved on to going to the cinema yourself. And of course, in those days, you didn't really get checked for your age. You would just go in and say, are you 18? Yes, because it was X certificate at the time. It was X double A in you, which was your certification. So the first one I saw was American Wealth in London, was the first X-rated film I saw, which that was, you went from Universal thinking that was great, and then you saw the next step for me, which was Hammer, which was a bit wow. Then you saw American Wealth in London, and you thought, this is the next level. And then you go on to see things like The Thing, the cinema, Friday the 13th, Part 3, in 3D, which was a cinema experience that I'll never forget. It was unreal. And then you've got the whole... So that's your sort of, that was me, was my progression. And this all happened when I was, I'm going to say, between the ages of 6 and 16, this 10-year period, it seemed to be predominantly with horror movies. But I think after that, that's when I got into more other movies, other genres of movies. I was just really, horror was my thing until I grew up a little bit and realized there was more to life than horror. And also getting back to banned videos, well, sort of, was the advent of the trying to track down the Bruce Lee movies, which were physically impossible. So we had so much problems with that, to see the uncut. And then you said, I've got one, there's a nunchaka scene in this one, nunchaka scene, double nunchaka scene in Way of the Dragon. You thought, yeah, I've got to see it. So that led me into the fact of, as well as searching the video nasties out, the uncut Bruce Lee ones led me into Jackie Chan and all of the other stuff. So that was a gateway to Chinese cinema. And then with Chinese cinema, you thought, hang on a minute, there's some Japanese cinema out there. And the Japanese stuff it's got some good horror elements, especially the old black and white Japanese movies, like Kuroneko, I think I'm going to pronounce that right, and Onibaba, I think that's correct. And you know that there's, you're just weaving your way through this. It's like a sort of kid. It's like a kid in a sweet shop that you can kind of, there's so much more out there. And the best thing about now, when you get to this point, is you can take all those things that you grew up with, and you can go searching for the Hammer stuff. You can go searching for the Universal Monster stuff, as well as your video nasties, which is like a never ending thing. But you've got this, and then Arrow. You go with the labels that you go for, like Arrow and 88 Films, they start to release a lot of martial arts. So you're thinking, right, this stuff was not really at all. It's not like it was kept away from you, but it was just not there. And now it seems like these people who are releasing these movies have got this love for it, which you can like. I picked up a movie called Yakuza Law, which I couldn't believe how violent it was for 1969. And I went, wow, what on earth is this? But these are things that are coming. I mean, I like other movies rather than violent movies. I don't just spend my life watching violent movies. But it's amazing to find these. I think it's like the progression of searching these things. When you go to these channels, these companies that do have a love for it as well. It's as if a fellow collector is collecting, is showing these movies off to you, I find. So I'm a big fan of 88 Arrow, who can show you the way when it comes to stuff that you, if you know, like the Shaw scope sets, when you think Shaw, like the Shaw brothers, you just think, and you get the point where you think, I pretty much think that most of those movies are going to be good. You can kind of trust Arrow to give you something that you're going to... The Gamera stuff, I mean, wow, that was a revelation. The Godzilla stuff, as you know, I mean, I know you're a huge fan of Godzilla and Gamera, and I enjoyed watching all your videos to do with that. It was so informative. But these are things that I feel that I don't know if it's come from the fact that I couldn't be able to see certain things, but I do think that the entry to Bruce Lee stuff has given me a huge pathway into martial arts cinema that's quite broad. And so that it's funny how you kind of look back on it and you've kind of navigated it in a way that you didn't expect to when you went to your first, when you watched, you watched your first whatever. I remember watching like Spider-Man movies with the Dragons Challenge, the 1978 1981 with some ninja in it and stuff. And you don't feel that you would ever progress into watching martial arts movies and stuff. It's weird how it's all come together. But I think at this point, well, for a good 10 years, it's been the coming together of everything is now, and it seems like it's all been worthwhile because you can just physically just literally get anything you want now.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. I mean, you're right. It's my I have a similar story, which is that when I was again living in the UK, late 80s, early 90s, my friends and I, we loved watching cartoons on TV, and one of the shows was Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. It was called Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles, and they had to delete or excise or remove all the nunchuck scenes for a reason that is similar to what you cited with regard to the handling and treatment of the release of Bruce Lee films. I understand what you mean by that, but also I understand too your reference and mentioning of these great labels, 88 films. I love 88 films and Arrow, of course. It's one of the premier labels right now, and there are other labels like Eureka with its martial arts releases. It's really very strong, and then there and then other labels like I don't know, like Indicator or something. It's a real glorious time. I guess, yeah, I mean, you brought it up, so that leads to my next question, which is, so what are some of those examples of some of these labels that you bring up and that you're very fond of? What are some examples of those classic titles that really did it for you and that really made you even stronger fans of these labels? Like, let's take Arrow, for example. What are some of those Arrow titles or Arrow sets that really stand out for you?
Well, it's funny because Arrow started out, I think City of the Living Dead was the first one that I came across, was the white box edition. Yeah. So I thought, wow, City of the Living Dead, fully uncut. And it picked it up, I think it was £18. And I thought it's got everything to do with it. It's got the posters, the everything. I thought, wow, it's got somebody to do that with. Not the greatest or best known Fulci film, I thought. Wow, it's a strange one to enter into. And then the Beyond came out, and there was loads of ones. So I was thinking that was going to be the zenith of collecting these movies. Dawn of the Dead came out in Arrow, which immediately got kind of, that was the first time when I heard a movie sort of go out of print, when I thought I bought it for £25, and then somebody was they were trying to buy them on eBay for £100. I'm going, what's going on? It's out of print. And I thought, well, why? Because I haven't been. They only had it for a certain length of time. They obviously bought it. I mean, obviously, we know a lot more about it now these days. Some people license it to a small amount. They release them, then they're done, and then they can't get them back. And then, well, speaking of Dawn of the Dead, how long was that out of print for? Because that was literally from maybe 2012 till that box set came out. You just couldn't get your hands on it. And, a movie like that should never be out of print. And So Arrow for me, when I branched, I could mainly collect all the Argento movies, and then that got me into the other ones that they put a lot of their banned horror movies out that I wanted to see: Driller Killer, Burning, Zombie Flesh Eaters, as it's known in the UK, and some obscure ones. There was the one called Microwave Massacre, which I loved when I used to watch it on VHS, and then it just vanished. So I got that one, and I had a blast going back to these old movies. The Herschel Gordon Lewis movies came out, which is ones that I've been dying to see. I'd seen Blood Feast, but I hadn't seen any of the other ones. And then you had a huge box set of that. So I like the fact that they'll take a director that maybe deserves it and they'll do it. Whereas Some places that just languish in obscurity, and Arrow seemed to be somebody who was going to champion these unknown directors or directors that needed to be seen. And they would put the spectacular releases out of them that they would look, the covers would be great, the editions would be amazing. And you had your choice if you wanted to get that, like the Gamera box set. I haven't got the Gamera box set, unfortunately, but it's colossal. The Godzilla Criterion version is just unreal, but huge and unreal. And I think that's, for me, Arrow was the ones that sort of were the first ones to take the video nasties and put them all out. And they're just, it's such a great thing to have a label doing that. So it was my go-to label for that. And then I could get into some of the Arrow Academy stuff. That made me branch out in a few of their stuff. And they've got quite a good range of things that they put out, which that don't fall into any other categories. I've got a couple that I've got one that I want to talk about, another one a bit later on. But it's a case of with 88 as well, they opened my eyes to, they started going into horror movies as well, banned horror movies, but they've gone a lot into these obscure 80s movies like The Eliminators, which is a great movie which I love, but it's I think that's out of print again, unfortunately. And they've got that huge, they've got the huge, the slasher collections and also the Italian collection, which is another thing that's making me look at movies that I've never seen before, would have never known about. And sometimes I'm having a huge revelation with these movies that are long forgotten, really, but spectacularly packaged and delivered to you.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's as if somebody has literally tapped into my brain and said, "What would you like to see?" And they've just put the whole stuff out, I find.
I love the 88. I love those series. Yeah, they have the what is it? The Asian cinema collection there, and then they have the Italian cinema, because I love that. I love that selection by the, and then those red, very skinny red cases for the slasher film collection that they have. There's really lovely with numbers and everything. So yeah, so those are really fantastic. And yeah, and they just kind of emerged, right? And then it was the rest, as they say, was history, and it just kind of exploded in terms of at least in the sort of communities that I think we find ourselves in. You know, we live for this stuff, right? When I don't know about you, when I go online, the first thing I see is, oh, what are some of the new releases out? Where is there anything on sale that I can buy on, you know, that sort of thing. So
Oh yeah, it's
yeah.
the go-to with that. And getting back to like Criterion as well, the Baby Cart movies, when they,
Yeah.
because we had seen the Baby Cart movies, and John Hollyer got us the DVD version. It was a terrible quality, but it was the only way I could watch it. And I've obviously watched Shogun Assassin, which was another one that fell foul and you couldn't get a hold of it. So the Shogun Assassin was my entry into that series. And then when I saw the Criterion one, which that was another revelation about the fact that, you know, when you appreciate when some label or some company has went and picked some and done the definitive version of it. And I like that some, you can see the love behind the release, and Baby Cart is one of the ones that really stands out to me for the whole deal, the package and everything.
And so that also brings me to another question, which is, you have a very impressive collection. It's incredibly impressive. It's something that it's part of the great appeal of your YouTube channel. Again, I'll say, you know, Mondo Chellovec Movies, and I'll have all the information in the description box of this video. So anyone who wants to check it out, please check it out, subscribe and comment, and check out as many videos as you can. It's really great. And one of the great features is you show a lot of your collection, and you have a very, very extensive collection. What is the how many titles approximately do you have right now? Do you know?
Well, it's funny enough, I'm in the process of counting the titles because, as you know, I had one wall full and I've made another wall because I ran out of space. I haven't reached my capacity yet. I'm still a
Okay.
way off that, but I've got there'll come a time when it'll have to be, and some decisions made as to what I actually keep on the shelves and how I move some of them into like other parts, you know, like probably be like some DVDs that I don't watch ever again. But I'm going to guess it's round about, I think the whole, if the walls are full, which they're getting there, it's about 3,000, I would say. It looks a lot more than actually, it looks, everyone says, is it not about 10,000? You go, no, it's not, no, it just looks huge because it's there.
That's amazing. That's amazing. What are some of the items that you particularly value? Now, I don't necessarily mean in terms of, say, a sellable value necessarily, but yeah, things that you personally value in particular of the things that you have in your collection.
Well, I think it's the fact that if I like Clockwork Orange, I like that I've got quite a few versions of it. Well, there's only one version of the movie, but I've got quite a few, you know, like I've got two VHS, I've got an American VHS. That's the one that I collect the most of. And they're all the same movie and usually the same features, but got different packaging. So I like the fact that I've got Clockwork Orange there. And also the fact that I've got a 4K section now. And the 4K section, when I first got it, I thought, well, when I think it was the same with Blu-ray. When Blu-ray first came out, it was like your big titles, your big blockbusters, which didn't really interest us that much. But as soon as I started a deep dive into the underbelly, I thought, right, it's time to get into Blu-ray. And it was the same with 4K. When 4K came out, it was your big blockbusters. Now it's starting to get very niche. So I'm all for that. So that's when I started collecting 4K. And to have the Blue Underground 4Ks that get released in the US, and you have these movies that came out and they just looks like perfect. I've never seen anything look so good in my life. You've got movies that introduce us to the Final Countdown, which is a movie I never thought I would ever, I didn't even know about. And then when I saw it, I thought, wow, this is such a good movie. And I do think that these movies, I just like the fact that the 4K section for me is, it has got some big films in it because some of the big films, you know, look good on 4K. But there's a lot of if you look at it, you don't see all blockbusters, you see cult, you know, the cult's getting bigger. And then if you go into the other sections, you see mainstream, but you've got your cult sections. And I like the fact that the cult isn't just definitive, it stops. This is like expanding as well. And I'm all for that, you know.
So how do you feel about the current marketplace right now? I mean, you mentioned, I think, elsewhere previously that now is a time where you can get a lot of things and it's a very exciting time. But now you mentioned 4K UHD releases, et cetera, and that's now part of your ever-growing collection. How do you feel about the state of things in terms of physical media at the moment? Are you happy the way things are? Are you hoping things go in a certain direction? Are you hoping for more attention made for this sort of film or that sort of film or these sorts of filmmakers? What's your feeling about the state of things at the moment?
Well, I'm happy the way that it's going. I think that it seemed to be coming to a part where there was a lot more. The only thing I think that the bad part of it now is the fact that when Arrow were releasing like a definitive version of City of the Living Dead, The Beyond, they were £18 and you had everything in one thing, and they were saying they would never double dip. It would just be a one shot. You would get it. It's done. Forget about it, which is great. But I think these days, when you're saying that you're getting like a definitive version coming out, it's like £70 and you go, wow. So it's the price tag. And I always look for sale items if I can, because especially when you go for your high ticket stuff like Showscope, £110. And to be honest, it's kind of worth that, but it's a large chunk to pay for an item. So you kind of want to get it in a bit of a sale, which I think I picked my Showscope Volume 1 up for £70, which was amazing in a sale. And I've just picked up Showscope Volume 2, but I've got it at full price because I was blown away by the first one that I knew I had to get this one immediately. So sometimes I do go for them. I think it's just, you've got to plan ahead. You've got to think, I've got my money. where does my money go in the best way? I think you've got to be a bit more shrewd these days. Unfortunately, I think if you go to know you can't own them all, you're in a better place, because if you try to buy them all, you could buy them back all back in the day, but if you try to buy them all now, you clean yourself out. So I think you've got to be a little bit more clever in that respect. That do you find that the movies these days seem to just have a little bit of an extra size and like amount in money on them?
Yes, I do notice that. And it prevents me from, say, I mean, there's some other great labels that are out there, like that are emerging, like I would say also Imprint.
Yes.
Imprint is also, I think, doing an excellent job. But unfortunately for me, I can't afford to get every single Imprint copy because they're quite expensive. And then add on to that shipping costs, et cetera. So it's a little bit out of my budget, unfortunately. Although I do have the occasional title here and there from them, so it's really quite impressive. And it's also same thing for Arrow. I love me some Arrow, definitely. Yes, whenever there's a sale that occurs, I'll try to take advantage of that where possible. And I'm very fortunate that they ship to where I am in Tokyo. And also points. I love their points. So whenever I can, I'll try to use their points as much as possible. Yeah. But you're right. That's something that I'm noticing a little bit more. It's getting a bit expensive. So it means that, yeah, maybe I might want to get this or might want to get that, but I'm going to have to hold off because, it's sometimes important to keep things to maintain a little bit self-control, I suppose. Yeah, it's always tempting, of course, but I totally understand what you're saying. Yeah,
well, that's good. That's a good point we made there about self-control, because if you wanted to buy everything and you had everything, and if you could afford everything, maybe you would have too much. So maybe this way around, with you having to, be accordingly with your budget, you might hold back on certain things, and you might, obviously that might make you go to get the best things that you need, the ones that you really need, not the ones that you think you might need, which isn't a bad thing in a way, because it kind of does curtail your addiction to maybe think that I'll have to, and that might not, it's like a way of self regulating your movies purchases or your shelf space. But financially has put a sort of limit on that.
and that's actually what I really like about a label like Arrow. You know, they have a custom of, say, initially releasing, say, the limited edition version of a particular, say, set or something that will be particularly appealing to fans of the film or people who are collectors of a particular type of film, etc., and that might have some extra special feature, like a booklet with some really nice essays and things of that sort, and that will be the limited edition. But then after a while that will run its course, and then a little bit later they'll come out with the standard version, which will be a little bit lower in price. It might not have all the limited edition feature, but it'll have all the basic stuff there, which is still quite excellent. So I like to have that option. Might not necessarily be able to afford all of the limited editions, but I might go for some of those standard editions at a more affordable price for me.
It's a good way of sort of saying, to be honest, if you've got like a movie that you love, you will go for the highest one. I mean,
of course,
for Argento's Phenomena, I knew I had to get the Creepers version, the Creepers box set, Creepers cover, because that was just a pure throwback to me looking at it on the video shelves, the VHS. So that made me think, I've got to get that. So me paying £35 for it was no problem, because that was... But say if I was not that interested in Phenomena and I thought, well, it's not my favourite, I could have let that go to be picking it up in a narrow sale for £8. So, that you have got that option. It's not as if when that Creepers cut's done, you're finished with it. It's still available. So that's a good point. You can always cut your cloth accordingly.
Yeah, I like that. And I like that. So you're referring to the 4K release of Phenomena, and it had various cover art design versions that one could choose.
Yeah.
you opted for the version that had the creepers artwork. Well done. Yeah. Well done. I went for the art original version, but the creepers were, I was debating which one to get. So, oh, well done. I'm very impressed with that choice.
Well, creepers, see, I'll go creepers. That would be me thing on that. But the art original is me next version I would get. And then I will go down to the if I don't think I've picked any of them in the shops. I've got the art original of Tenebrae, which I do like. And that's another one that you think that looks spectacular in 4K, because the version that Arrow had a poor Blu-ray of it. It did look a bit, it was just not right, but the 4K is spectacular. So I'm glad they've been able to, it gets back to these things where, you know, you look for, when you see a movie coming out, they go back to the original negatives and you know a little bit more about the fact of these days. I don't know anything about really that type of thing, but you can know that if you've got this original negatives version somewhere, you can know that you're going to expect something a little bit more. Some of this coming into our knowledge, whereas these days, back in the day, 2012 or 11, Arrow, you just would pick it up and it would just say remastered or something. So now you know. So say if they haven't went back the original negatives, you may even think, well, I'm not really too sure about getting that one, because I'm thinking the original negatives might turn up somewhere, which it has done in some movies.
Yeah. Speaking of Tenebrae, that's one where it was, for me anyway, impossible to watch when I was growing up as a kid. I wouldn't be able to find it anywhere.
Yeah.
And so it took me a while to catch up with that one. But now it's made gloriously available in so many options, including that great set. Yes, I also have the art original version of the Arrow 4K. It's glorious. Absolutely glorious. And all of its, all of its Argento glory. So, John, this is so great. You know, you have a great expertise of cinema and you have a wonderful collection and you show this passion and energy and love through many ways, including your YouTube channel. And so before we go, I'd like to give you the opportunity maybe to, again, tell us about your YouTube channel. What do you have planned coming up? What are some things that maybe, again, for people who might be meeting you for the first time, please let us know about your channel and any upcoming plans or any videos that you might have in store. I know you said you're talking about video nasties. Are there any other videos that you like to plug or you'd like to mention in particular?
I've got a few sort of things in the pipeline. I've got one where I find these books from yesteryear, and I found sort of the movies that I've watched in 1986, I've got all of them written down. So I'm going to go through a video of everything that I watched in the year of 1986. That's the only year I've ever done that. And I think I've got some ones that I've watched in 2 months in 1987, so they'll come out. And it'll be about as retro as I can do. And I can try and, if I've got the actual things I watched from 1986, I can show them, I can hold them up, or I can put on screen what this movie was. Some of the movies I can't even remember watching. So I've got that. And I also want to do, when I first started my channel, I did want to do music, a lot of music on there. I show people how to make music. And I've got this very sort of easy to navigate recording studio, a 12-track recording studio, so I've got my garage. So I want to, I've got the stuff to do it. It's just finding the time. And obviously the light in the garage is terrible. And it's freezing in the garage as well. So I want to show people how I would make up a song from scratch, and show how you put the drums on it and how your guitar. And I would never sing. I can't sing. But it would be everything bar that. So I'd love to have that as a part of it wouldn't probably never be a full video, but it would be a part of it. You could see maybe half the video. You could say, look, this is how you record the drums to this, or how you make something that way. How do you get the drums? How do you speed up on the drums? How do you make the drums as fast as you can? That type of thing. I've got a big love of punk music, so that might come into there. And there might be ways where I could collaborate with other people. A load of people play instruments in the channels and the channels I follow, so maybe I could collaborate with them, and that would be really fun. And that's something I've wanted to do 2.5 years ago when I started the channel, but never really got around to it. So that's something I would really like to do. And then I'm going to talk about, I've got live streams. I do other live streams apart from that. And I go on to live streams as well. And there's going to be stuff where I can go maybe into 88 films, titles, different genres. I'm really talking about stuff, but I need to watch a few more of these movies before I do it, going more deep diving into the various things to do with Asian cinema and things like that. But I've got a lot of plans. It's just finding the time, as you know, and putting them in place. But there's some weird ones coming up, as well as your normal ones where you can go out and about and pick things up and say, look, I've just went to the shop and I've just bought these ones, and this is what you can get maybe if you want to see it. And the 4K is great, or the 4K is awful, you know, that type of thing. Maybe it's something for that they can get, people can get a bit of an idea of what maybe not to go for or what to go for, kind of.
Oh, fantastic. So Mondo Chellovec Movies, all the information will be made available in the description box below. So my strong hope and please go to the channel, check out all the videos you can, subscribe, leave comments, thumbs up, anything that you can to support our dear friend John. You can see that he has a love and passion for cinema and many sorts and many kinds, and his collection is outstanding. So Mondo Chellovec Movies, John, thank you so much. Before you go, please, do you have any recommendations for us? Anything that you'd like to share with us? Anything that you think might be worth considering if we're in the shops, wondering what to buy?
Well, I've got three things here which I just want to talk about quickly. And the first thing I want to talk about is a movie called, which I was one of the people I sort of like follow on here. Leon Talks Films. Leon got me to look at his favorite movie, which is a movie called Buffalo 66. Have you seen that one? Yeah. And this was a bit of a revelation for me, because he said it was a great movie and it would be a movie that would excite me in the way of the sort of the down by law look, the sort of very much independent movie making. And this one just ticked all the boxes for me. The story is so good about this guy who's very much down in his luck. And he does kidnap her. And takes her to his mom and dad's house and has this sort of meeting. It's very strange. It's like surreal comedy, very uncomfortable at times. But you get some brilliant performances from Christina Ricci and Vincent Gallo. And it's actually a film by Vincent Gallo as well. So, so that's the first one. That was a recommendation from Leon. The next one is a one that's... going back to me cinema days, when I went to the cinema and I watched this movie, because I watched lots of horror movies when they came out, parts 1, 2, and 3 and all that. This one came out and I was utterly shocked and maddened by it. And it was Halloween 3. But because Michael Myers wasn't in it. So what happened was, like 39 years later, or 37 years ago, later on, a channel called Euphoria Pictures, Keith, he said to me, you've got to watch this movie and don't give it one more shot. Now, Ad says, well, I've got a lot of history with it. I've got a lot of problems with the fact that it really annoyed me at the time. But fast forward again to the 4K, the amazing 4K from Screen Factory. This looks unreal, unbelievable. But he sent me the DVD, the Blu-ray, and I watched it. And I thought, as a standalone movie, it's great. It is a great movie. I really do appreciate it and love it now. But it's to sort of showcase the fact of how good these movies can look on 4K. Absolutely amazing. And the last one I want to talk about is the one that you gave me a recommendation for way back when. And I remember you talking about this movie and I thought, that one sounds really interesting. And I thought, will I ever get it? And there was a lot that was very expensive, but I did get it on Arrow. And it was Decalogue. Now, I don't have to tell you how good this is. When I put it on, I mean, I got it with your recommendation. You talked about it and you talked about the aspect of what it was about, the 10 episodes. And it's one of those ones where I could not stop watching it. I had to watch the next episode, the next episode, the next episode. And this is a Polish movie. It's a Polish TV series, actually. Although some of them were made into full-length movies. But this is a spectacular. And you can still get it from Arrow. It's never went out of print. Although this is the smaller version because I couldn't afford the bigger version. That's another thing we're talking about. And so that was a recommendation from yourself. And it's one of the best things I've ever seen, if I'm honest. So that's my recommendations.
John, thank you so much for that. That really makes me very happy. Those three titles are wonderful. And I have the same love for Halloween 3. Believe me, I love that film to bits. So I'm so happy that you mentioned that. So, John, this has been such a great pleasure for me. Thank you so much. I had so much fun. Let's do this again very soon, if that's okay.
I'd love to.
And once again, Mondo Chellovec Movies. All the information will be in the description box of this video. And please subscribe, comment, thumbs up, do anything you can to support John, support him and many other people within this this community doing lots of very important, great stuff, great videos. So, John, thank you so much. And let's talk again very soon.
Yeah, I loved that. And thanks very much for getting me on here, Daisuke. I've really enjoyed this.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'll talk to you very soon.